And it's true. It's another episode of GM Talks. Welcome. Today I will have a little look at talents. It's a dangerous word, and I'm going to get into that because I'm very interested in how you improve at chess. As a national coach for Denmark, with the responsibility over our talents, I'm looking much into what to do to make them get the most out of their talent, and what to do not to sort of destroy the talent. The first thing that's very important, and that's the toxic words, is you should never, ever say to anyone, "You are a big talent." This is just a mistake. Don't say you're a big talent. And why is that? Because talent is a bad word. I don't like it. Talent tells you that you're like some God-gifted player and you will just be fantastic without working. And here's the truth. Nobody ever gets really good at chess without working. It just doesn't happen. You have no chance of becoming very good without working hard. So, what should you use instead? You should say potential. You have the potential to become very good. Because potential tells you that you are not very good, but you got some skills and you can improve to be very good. When you tell people they're big talents, even if they're hard workers, they will tend to become a little bit more like what I'll call local heroes. That you just, okay, I'm the best here and I'm very talented and I don't have to work as hard as the others. And that's clearly a mistake. So even if you don't say, okay, I know the word talent is bad, it's toxic, I don't like it, so I will just forget you said anything about it, and say you still will have it in the back of your head that you're a very talented player and you're sort of entitled to get something extra without working as hard as the others who's got less talent. And this is the problem. So don't, if you want to, you know somebody and you're envious of their play and you think they're very good and so on, just tell them they're really big talent. Maybe the biggest talent you ever saw, because then they will stop working and they will not be as good as they could have become. So use the word potential. That's much, much better. I'm going to show you a game now. We'll shift the scene. And this is the game with Curt Hansen. And why I'm going to show something with Curt Hansen is because Curt Hansen was a player with fantastic potential. He was a big talent, for sure. And he was also told he was a big talent. He came from a very small city in other parts of Jutland in Denmark, and became European champion and junior world champion for juniors. And he should have become one of the best players in the world, but somehow along the way he stopped developing and didn't achieve his full potential. And I was kind of smile when I heard the word full potential, because my son used to watch this Ninjago from Lego, and they use this for the green ninja. But anyway, it's a good phrase. Your full potential you will only reach if you really give it all, if you're really burning to uncover all the secrets of chess. And somewhere along the way, things was too easy for Kurt for a long time. Here we'll see a game with another great talented player from the World Junior Championship in 1984 in Finland, and it's Georgiev, and Kurt is white, and it's a good example of how a talented player, just the national flow of the game. He was so good at calculating far. He even got a match against Kasparov, not for the world championship, of course, but because he almost beat Kasparov at the Olympiad, and Kasparov said, "Okay, I want to beat this guy," and came to Denmark and played on some castle in the little island Fyn. It was a great story, anyway. Kurt Hansen lost, but he did show up a good fight. And this is known as the semi-terrace. It's very, very popular at the moment at the top level. It's a bit annoying. And the main line here is E4, but you can also play the E3, which if he takes and play bishop E4 will transpose into some kind of Panoff variation. But this is still in the what we call semi-classical Queen's Gambit. That's very long-haired. This is all theory. Bum bum bum. And this move, Black doesn't do anymore. This is wrong. It saddles White with what we call hanging pawns, but White's attack on the king side simply gets too strong. So a much better move is bishop f6. I'm just going to show you here, and I think Black equalizes here. This should be fine. He will follow up with something like knight here, and then play b6 and bishop b7 or bishop d7 and bishop c6. And he should be fine. If White goes knight e4, you just don't care about it. You just go here anyway and take back with the knight, and keeping control over d5 is the most important thing. Instead, he takes, and this position is now known as clearly but slightly better for White. But okay, they didn't know that back in 1984. There was a lot of things they didn't know back then. They didn't have computers, and the computer will already give White a clear advantage because his attacking chances is simply too good. B6, normal move. Notice that Black's structure is better. He has two pawn islands versus three pawn islands, and potentially the pawn on c3 and d4, these guys here, could be weak. And the bad things about having hanging pawns, as they are called, is that if you lose one of the pawns, then you are settled with a very weak isolated pawn. It's not unlike when you have an isolated pawn and you lose that pawn, you just lost a pawn. Here you're likely to lose two pawns, so then you're sure to lose the game. So it's a bit more considered a bit more risky to have hanging pawns. But they also have some dynamics. Bishop d3. This diagonal is important. Attacking the king. We also know that because of the c file, the e file here, White has a clear space advantage on the king side. So Black has to be careful. Bishop b7, normal move, and here comes this was a novelty. No, not a novelty at the time. People have already started playing this, and it's a very good move. H4, sacrificing a pawn, but in due time they found out that taking the pawn is simply too risky because White goes here. And he's already threatening rook h3, but also just rook d3 and bishop d5. And Black will come under a very, very dangerous attack. And it's a long-term attack where White will keep compensation for a long time. And Black simply gave up on this position. In a practical game, it's not practical to play this way. So instead, he plays bishop f6. It's also... But that allows, of course, knight to come in. And if h6, you can maybe go to h7 and take the bishop pair anyway. So, and this starts to look a bit dangerous. Queen g4, getting all the pieces into what Ogard in his nice book about attacking chess calls the kill zone. Getting it very close to the king. So there will be a lot of checks and a lot of different attacking ideas. White is already ready for h4, h5. And that will be... and then something will land on h7 or e6. And Black is even though it looks like he has a very healthy position, he's under a strong attack already. h5 stops the pawn, but of course weakens this guy, because it used to have two pawns behind it, now it has only one. But it prevented the h-pawn from joining the game. Queen d3, and this is, of course, a very nice move, getting to the rescue, bolstering this pawn, and maybe if you can play knight f5, black will be happy to do that. And Curt, he had a position like this before and realized that the bishop was very strong here, because rook e8 is not something you really want to do. And but he probably should do it anyway. I don't know. He played rook c8, and here lightning strikes. And this also shows, I'm going to talk about a little bit about Kurt's talent. He was a very talented player. He was extremely good at making long calculations. Most of us have big troubles in that. It's when you see one move ahead, okay, that's easy. Two moves ahead, maybe that's easy also. But four moves ahead and calculate maybe long lines of six, seven, eight moves, it's very difficult because your head becomes fuzzy. You just can't seem to get the lines moving in your head. But Curt was very good at that. He was very good at calculating long forced lines. He did reach the top 20 in the world, and was a strong player for the Bundesliga team Porch in Germany. He won some tournaments and had, I think, a peak rating around 26, 34 or something. But he probably could have become much better if he was more ambitious. But he didn't really like the life as a chess player, which is also important, because if you don't like what you do, he liked chess, but he didn't like the travel, he didn't like the hotels, he thought it was boring and kind of lonely, and now he's not playing very much. Sometimes as people get him to play a little bit, but mostly he's not playing, and he doesn't really enjoy playing, I think, at the moment. And still, he's of course a very strong player, but it never really, the potential he had was to become much, much better than he did. And I was always very afraid of him. I won some games against him, and I lost a lot of games against him. He was really the big nasty teacher, by example, by just destroying me when calculating long forced lines. But he gave me some of my education in chess. Anyway, bang! Did you see that? Okay, I don't know if you saw that. White gets all the pieces into the attack. Of course, g6 will become weak. He has to take, otherwise you'll just take f8 and you're behind too much on material. And the rook joins the game, the bishop joins the game. There's already threatening bishop takes e7 and queen takes g6, and it will be mate. Covers e7, and what do talented players do in positions like this? They of course just keep getting pieces into the attack. This is one of Ogard's other ideas in his attacking manual, is when you're holding a party, invite all your friends. And the rook on a1 just needed to enter the action. Black has no way of saving this. And by the way, this Kiril Georgiev is a very strong player. And he has been a world elite player throughout the 80s, the 90s, and part of the zeros, and he's still a strong player. And here we go. Another one bites the dust. And he has to give material, and of course it's pretty hopeless. Bang, bang, bang. And here he, of course, could resign, but he didn't. And it's all over. This was a nice little game against a strong player. I'm gonna show you some other games by Curt Hansen later on this YouTube channel. And if you like this video and if you thought about this potential versus talent was interesting, please subscribe or like the channel. We are waiting to grow the audience. Thank you for watching.